business online. We hope we get to you. We're going to open up in a word of prayer. Brother Pat Weaver, would you lead us in prayer? Okay, we're going to sing Leading on the Everlasting Arms, number 333 in your green book. Most of my nose is going to be on the board. Set our thoughts back an hour, try to gain back some of that energy we lose on you, but so, John.
Sing Friday night.
But Friday night we've got a full day Friday. We start with breakfast and then we end it with dinner and singing at the Mule Day grounds, and we're sponsoring that. So come out and support the singers and sing along and have a good time and have some good chicken privilege. And next Tuesday is midterm election day. A lot of important people, a lot of important slots to be filled next Tuesday. And we need to voice our opinion and cast our vote so we can have a say on who goes into those offices. That's the only say so we got. And pray for those that you want to have in there. Okay, let's turn to number 335. Standing on the promises. Let's stand while we stand on the promises. Standing on the promises of Christ find me. Through eternal ages they can freeze and free. Glory in the highest God we shall then see. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Promises that cannot fail. When the heavens come together, He will sail. By the living word of God, I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord. Bound in eternally by the sword. Overcome, remaining with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior, stand me. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot hold. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises of God.
Thank you, Neil. We're, believe it or not, on the fourth study in the book of Ecclesiastes. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for what it teaches us about life here. We thank you for this particular book written by the wisest man that ever lived, who messed up his own life, but teaches us much of what you laid on his heart to put down in Scripture. We pray that we'll pay attention, not make the same mistakes Solomon made, but learn from him. Thank you for your word, and I pray it's only your word that we remember tonight. In Christ's name, amen. Here's one of the most famous passages in Scripture. And unfortunately, it's not a famous passage in Scripture for all the right reasons. It isn't because a lot of Christians study it and preach it or read it. It's because the lost world has heard songs about it. I'm going to talk about that. It's been sung by saved and lost people alike. This passage in chapter 3. Life is full of opposites. We experience opposites in every aspect of our life. Every one of them we've all experienced up till now. And we're going to experience more. Solomon records this in chapter 3 and verse 1. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to cast away, a time to rend, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time of war, and a time of peace. Opposites. We experience them all in life. And life goes on this way. And we make the mistake sometimes of being depressed over the hard things to endure, forgetting that this is a description of life. This is what happens to us all here. We've all experienced almost all of these things. There's one particular thing here that caught my attention that I want to tell you about. A time to gather stones together and a time to cast away stones. I was a young kid in upstate New York in farm country. If I took you to where I grew up, at the time I grew up, it would put you in mind of Grady County. That's what it looked like. It wasn't the same temperature. I was 18 miles from Canada. It's cold, frozen ground in October, even in September, some years. But there were farmers' fields where most of the farming there was beef cattle, dairy cattle, fruit trees. We had peaches, believe it or not, Golden Jubilee peaches in New York State. Apples, mostly apples, Macintosh apples, cherries, plums, every fruit you can imagine. But there were also fields where truck crops were grown. And glaciation had occurred with the ice age that occurred after the flood of Noah. And it had made huge gouges in upstate New York when the ice came down and then receded. It made the Finger Lakes. And the Finger Lakes, the deepest of which is Lake Seneca. It's the largest Finger Lake. They look like scratch marks of someone's fingers on the earth. And Seneca Lake was 1,200 feet deep. It was made by ice receding. Well, there were boulders that were pushed by the ice. And boulders were everywhere. Some of them were too big to move with heavy equipment. Some of them could be picked up by a man. The ones that could be picked up by a man That was the job of late teens, like me at that time. And I would be hired and paid money to gather stones together and put them in hedgerows on the edges of these farmers' fields. And we'd pick them up and carry them, the one we could pick up. Sometimes two of us would carry one. And we'd get them out of where it was going to be plowed and put into hedgerows. The hedgerows were all boulders, rectangular fields that were cleared and plowed and planted, and hedgerows of boulders. It was a great place to do pheasant hunting. For some reason, the pheasants loved those boulders. We'd walk along the edge of the fields, past the boulders, pheasant would fly out, shoot it, and it was just a great time. But here it is in the Bible, a time to gather stones together and a time time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. So Solomon is observing everyday things that are happening in life. Life, born, people dying, all of these things happen to all of us. Well, this passage of Scripture is best known, I'm afraid, not from Christians studying the Bible and reading this and having it preached. It's best known because during the Vietnam War, Pete Seeger took this passage out of Scripture and wrote a song. And it was in 1965, and this was a Vietnam War protest song. And he never gave credit to it being in the Bible. Someone asked him once where the words came from, and this is what he said. He said it was some sandal-footed guy that lived about 2,000 years ago, and his name was Ecclesiastes. He said, that's all I know. And the world was singing. It went to number one on the charts. Many groups sang it, but the famous one was by the Birds. Candy, why don't you come up here and lead us in? That's my wife. Asking me to do something she knows I'd never do.
Sing a little more. Yeah.
Well, that was the world's look at the Bible. But all of these things do happen, and they happen to all of us in life. And that's why they're here. Because the man that God said was going to be wiser than anyone that would ever live put him here after his observations of life as king of Israel. Well, he's king no longer at the time of this writing. What Solomon was observing, he observed through personal experience. All of these things happened to him in life. And they're events that are vastly different from one another. In verse 9 of chapter 3, it says this, what profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which God hath given to the sons of men to be exercised in. He hath made everything beautiful in his time. Here's another verse of Scripture that was made into a popular song by B.J. Thomas. Everything is beautiful in its own way. Comes from Ecclesiastes. The world is singing the Bible and doesn't know it. Isn't that crazy? We Christians, largely the ones I've talked to, have avoided the book of Ecclesiastes. It's kind of depressing. All these observations about life being filled with troubles. It's not a happy book, but it's the truth. Don't forget, these aren't Solomon's words. He's inspired by God to put them down to remind us that this is what we can expect in life. All of the things that are here that were in the song that the birds made popular, that Sager wrote, happened to every one of us. Lost and saved people. All of us in here have probably experienced these same opposites in life. Births. I just had two great-grandchildren born. I've got a great-grandchild that knows me by name. It's mind-boggling. I've seen death in my family. Lost my father when he was 59 years old. I got to thinking this week as I was reading this scripture. I left home when I was about 18. Well, I was exactly 18. I went off to college. And in the summers, I was working away from home at a boys' camp. I was the maintenance man in a boys' camp. I wasn't around my father very much after the age of 18. My father died when he was 59. After college, I was in the Marine Corps for 6 years. I got married. I was a flight instructor in California. Didn't see my dad. He lived in New York. Then my mom and dad moved to Florida. And I thought about my relationship with my father and how close it was. He did that. He made it close, although we were far apart. He was a writer, good writer. And he wrote me some letters that I've saved that it just made me experience his life more than his death. When his death occurred, I was in Okeechobee, Florida. We had four kids. My dad died of lung cancer at the age of 59. It was a hard thing. But as I've gone on in age, and now I'm much, much older than my father ever got, and I'd only spent just not even 20 years with him. I think of all the things we did together, all the things he taught me. And it was wonderful. So I've got these feelings of sadness over his death, but I've got these feelings of gratefulness for how he taught me so much about life that has helped me so much. And it's like he's with all these things. The moving of stones, casting away stones, and gathering them together. We used to go down to the beach on Lake Ontario. The waves were crashing into the beach all the time. All the stones were flat. We kids would go down there and you could throw until your arm fell off, skipping stones back into Lake Ontario from the shoreline. Throw them all day. There were thousands upon thousands flat stones of all sizes. Some you couldn't pick up. Some were tiny. But there were plenty that were just nice skipping size. And that's what we did. We laugh and skip stones. And I thought about this passage and I said, you know, this passage describes life. Think about your life. Read these first eight verses of Ecclesiastes. Think about you. To everything, there's a season and a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. I lost a very good friend this week. Terrible. Last week. A time to plant. A time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill. I've experienced that. A time to heal. Time to break down, and time to build up, time to weep, who hasn't wept, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. I remember I came back from, when I went to Vietnam, I came back to the States, Hawaii, to meet Candy. Candy was teaching school in California. And she went to Hawaii ahead of me. And I flew in. And the wives of all of the guys on R&R, Rest and Recuperation, we call it, the wives were in a line opposite each other. And the guys off the plane would walk down that line, and their wife would grab them. Oh, because you couldn't tell who was who. It was just, you know, a couple of hundred wives in a line facing each other. And I felt this little Italian girl grab me and pull me, and it was him. It was a happy time. When I came back from Vietnam, Candy was in the room where all of us were being debriefed. The debriefing, I swear to you, took an hour. We were sitting unable to join our loved ones. It was the dumbest thing the Marine Corps ever did, I thought. We were sitting there listening to a debrief that was going in one ear and out the other. We didn't know what we were going to be in for back in the States. I was in California. All the flower children were out there, and they were warning us about what was going to happen, about how much we were hated. And Candy's over there crying. Time to refrain from embracing. That was it. The only time I've ever refrained from embracing Candy. But it happened to me in life, and all of these things happen to all of us. This is life. And this is why it's here. It's to remind us that something didn't go wrong when some loved one died. What happens. It's part of life. And it's okay. The reason it's okay is because of Jesus. For the Christian, when we receive what is this?
That's James' microphone.
We good? Can you hear me? Let's see. No, that's okay. You did right. Let me read these two verses. Chapter 3, verse 12, 13. I know that there is no good in them, but for a man to rejoice and to do good in his life, and also that every man should eat, drink, and enjoy the good of all his labor. It is the gift of God. I've heard people say, gee, Solomon sounds kind of depressed. It sounds like he's saying, let's eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow we die. This point. This point is that God has given us every good thing for us to experience. And there's nothing wrong with us doing that in our lifetime. My favorite commentator, I told you before, is Matthew Henry. I copied an excerpt out of Matthew Henry concerning these two verses. It's this, I'm going to read it. I don't know how a man that lived at the time of Matthew Henry, 1700, could have gotten so much out of reading the same Bible that I read. And I told you before that the Bible has a certain number of words in it. Matthew Henry's commentary on the Bible has about 40 times as much words as the Bible. This is what he says about these verses is kind of every man should eat, drink, and enjoy the good of all his labor. It is the gift of God. I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it or anything taken from it. And God doeth it, that men should fear before him. This is what Matthew Henry says. We must be pleased with our lot in this world and cheerfully acquiesce in the will of God concerning us and accommodate ourselves to it. There is no certain lasting good in these things. What good there is in them, we are here told. We must make a good use of them for the benefit of others. All the good there is in them is to do good with them to our families, to our neighbors, to the poor, to the public, to its civil and religious interests. What have we, our beings, capacities, and estates for, but to be some way serviceable to our generation? We mistake if we think we were born for ourselves. No, it is our business to do good. It is in doing good that there is the truest pleasure. And what is so laid out is best laid up and will turn to the best account. Observe, it is to do good in this life, which is short and uncertain. We have but little time to be doing good in, and therefore had need to redeem time. It is in this life where we are in a state of trial and probation for another life. Every man's life is his opportunity of doing that which will make him make for him an eternity. For our own comfort, let us make ourselves easy, rejoice and enjoy in the good of our labor, as it is the gift of God. And so enjoy God in it, and taste his love, return him thanks, and make him the center of our joy. Eat and drink to his glory, and serve him with joyfulness of heart, in all the abundance of all things. If all things in this world be so uncertain, it is foolish, a foolish thing for men sordidly to spare for the present, that they may hoard up for all in hereafter. It is better to live cheerfully and usefully upon what we have, and let tomorrow take the thought for the things of itself. Who said that? Jesus. Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 6, 33 and 34. Grace and wisdom to do this is the gift of God. So, I used to think Solomon was horribly incorrect and making a grave mistake when he said, let's eat, drink, and be merry. Because it sounded to me like he was saying, because tomorrow we're just going to die. So let's forget everything else in the world and just take care of ourselves. It's not his point at all. He's saying God does good things and only good things, only right things. And what we experience in life is what every person on this earth has experienced before us. It's not necessarily that God has given up on you when you have suffered the loss of a loved one. It's not a punishment from God. It's the way things are. Solomon goes on to say, listen to this, verse 20 of chapter 3. All go to one place, all are dust, and all turn to dust again. Where's that from?
That's returning.
Genesis 2:7. Right, I knew you'd know.
Right.
God formed man of the dust of the ground. And in Genesis 3:19, unto dust shalt thou return. He tells Adam. This is not a happy memory I have, but I've never forgotten. In fourth grade, I went to Bible camp on the shore of Lake Ontario, way out east of where I live, farm country. They were doing things at the Bible camp to make room for other buildings, and one of the things they had to do was dig up a cemetery that was there. I've always confused about that my whole life. Even to this day, I was thinking about it today, and wondering whether I was going to share it tonight. Came in and dug with shovels, men, like six or eight men, I remember, digging with shovels in this graveyard and digging up caskets. And these caskets, some of them were from when my immigrant ancestor came to this part of the world in the 1600s, 1700s. We all us kids, I was in the fourth grade, or 9 years old, 10 years old, and I was thinking, there's going to be smelly bodies in there. Ew. But we were so curious, we wanted to peek. Look, we were told to get away, and we'd get closer. When nobody was looking, we'd get closer to look. I remember the first time they broke through a lid. Asking what I saw. The dust. That's all that was there. It wasn't a skeleton. It was nothing but dust. It didn't mean anything to me then, but we were all looking at each other going, where is he? Guess that was empty. They were all empty. You know why? Because dust thou art, and unto dust you will return. It doesn't matter if you die at sea, get cremated, buried in a coffin. It doesn't matter. That's what happens. It's in the Bible. I think if you read it in the Bible, rest assured, that's what happens. It doesn't happen to all people. There's going to be some Christians on the earth that don't die that death. The older I get, the more I think it's in my immediate future. But I'm sure people that got to be my age have thought that throughout the centuries. If things are getting so bad, the rapture's going to take place. I think it's close. A lot of people have thought it was close. The Bible seems so harsh until the arrival of Jesus. You see, Jesus changes everything. Not necessarily our experience compared to Solomon's. Solomon sinned. Has anybody in here lived and not sinned yet? I know the answer. We've all sinned. Solomon is dust. Here he writes to us things that will stand the test of time. God forms man from the dust of the ground, and then he tells man he's going to return to dust. There's an exception, and his name is Jesus. Jesus came into this world so that we can have life and have it abundantly. And that doesn't mean we're all going to be rich and never have to worry about money again. What it means is We are adopted into God's family. Jesus is going to return. And if you're buried, or if you're in the ocean, burial at sea, it doesn't matter. If you were burned in a fire, if you were made ashes in a day, or if you were made ashes over a series of years in a casket, none of it makes any difference. The dead in Christ are going to rise, and then Paul says, we, thinking himself, which are alive and remain, will be gathered up together with them. So since the time of Christ, people have thought the rapture was imminent. And in God's view, I'm sure it is imminent. I know it's been 2,000 years, but the Bible says a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. God isn't confined by our concept of time. He's coming. And Jesus is coming in the air. And those who believe in him, those who have trusted him, he went to the cross willingly when he didn't have to. He could have stopped it all. I really think that Christ's crucifixion took place when it did, because if it happened today, there would have been 5,000 people with AR-15s preventing it from happening by killing anybody that was trying to crucify Jesus. So it happened when it did, because no one could fight against the Romans or the priest, the high priest. The people were helpless. And it was God's will that man would not stop Jesus from dying on the cross, because he was going to be buried in a tomb. Was going to be resurrected in 3 days. And the promise was then given that all of those who believe in him would have everlasting life. And whether they die, and some of the men that I looked at in those caskets when I was in fourth grade may have been Christians. They were dust. I don't know where their dust went after that day. And it doesn't matter. Because God is going to take every one of you who have received Christ as your Savior to heaven. You don't have to worry about anything in life. Have you had hardships in life? Of course you have. Are you going to have more? As long as you live, yes, you will. Something didn't go wrong in your life when that happens. That's a description of life from the Bible. Here, by the wisest man that ever lived. It tells you, all of these things happen. Some sound good, some sound bad. Everything happens the same way to all of us. But here's what hadn't happened yet when Solomon wrote. Jesus had not yet come. He's going to come. In our life, he came. And in our life, he's coming again. Or future time, he's coming again. So, as we look at the book of Ecclesiastes, and we look at these things about dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return, they're true observations that Solomon has seen happen in his life. But it's not the end of the story. The end of the story is life everlasting. It says, the grass withereth, and the flower thereof fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. And what he tells us is not to worry. Sure, some bad experiences happen to us in life. I think of Sonny Lee going out to burn some trash, throwing what he thought was diesel on a fire. And an explosion occurs. cross back into the house. I know where Sonny is. He's with Jesus. That's where we'll go if we trust in God's word. The agony that Solomon is yet going to write about, that we're going to look at, that comes from living a life here in this earth, isn't the end of the story. It's nothing to fear. It's something to rejoice over. Our Father, I thank you for loving us so much that you were willing to send your very Son to die in our place, so that those who believe in his death, burial, and resurrection, and invitation by him that we should trust in him, could have eternal life. Thank you for making it so simple a young child could understand. I pray that if anyone is listening to this that hasn't yet trusted Christ, I pray that they would. Jesus came to this earth for one purpose: to offer mankind a way to be adopted into the family of God. All you have to do is believe that in your heart and say, I want that, God. I want to trust Jesus as my Savior. And you'll have promise, not from me, but from God, that you will have eternal life with him. God, I thank you for that. I thank you for making the gospel so simple a child can understand. And I pray that if there's anyone who is struggling with that, that's listening, will realize you have a plan for their life. If they will only say, I want to trust in Jesus. I pray that you'd cause us to look at the rest of the book of Ecclesiastes and see ourselves in it, and quit complaining about the hard things in life. And I pray that we'd open our ears to the revelation that Solomon gives us about how it is we should live. We thank you for that. In Christ's name, amen.
Can I take a couple of minutes? Thank you so much, Brother Duke. I just want to make a couple of comments about the two verses, chapter 3, verses 12 and 13. I did a funeral yesterday for an 86-year-old lady that we've known many years. And I talked about this principle in her life, the impact she made in the business world, in her family, in her community, because she was a very strong lady in so many ways. But I don't want to talk about her. I want to talk about what Duke touched on, is the labors that we can be pleased with. God's given us a gift to do something. He said there's no good in us. We're just dust. But he put us here to make a contribution into the world. We can't find out how it's all made. We don't understand the birds and the bees. Literally, we don't understand all about honeybees. They're very mystical insect. We don't understand about fish. We know something about them. We can't find out all about that, but we all make a contribution. And the older I get, I see the bigger picture. And I think about Sherry and her career in teaching. I think about Mr. Biscuit. Where is he today? A number of years ago, we talked about Biscuit here in the morning devotion for the children. And we laugh because of his nickname. Don't know what his real name was, doesn't matter. But I'm sure he's an adult by now. But Sherry made a contribution to his life. How it ever happened to him, it's a lasting impression. Her legacy is wrapped up in students across Grady County and all the other teachers. I think about a friend of mine that roofed houses. And we drive around and he said, I did that roof 12 years ago. I did that roof 20 years ago. I think about my wife's doctor who saw hundreds of patients and took kidney stones and infections and bladder problems and kidney problems. He helped people. And when he drove around town, he could smile because his labors, he was gifted enough to help somebody get well. I think about my own career and the lives that I help put some people in jail that need to be locked up, need to be in a cage, and to protect other people. And I think about how our lives are spent like a shuttle. Later on, he says, Proverbs, we're just a few days and full of trouble, and our lives are spent. It's like a vapor, here for a little while, pass away. But we make a contribution. And that verse hit me when he said that we don't understand it all, there's no good in us, but we can look around and have some joy about what we did while we were here. You might have quilted a quilt. You might have crocheted an afghan. You might have cooked a good meal for somebody. I ran into a man last week at an event, and I'd completely forgotten about something. He said, you're the one that did this. I said, I forgot all about that. God keeps records. He's got a book, and he'll know when we get there. It says our works follow us. It says in Revelation that being dead, we still speak. Even after we're gone, folks will be talking about what we said or what we didn't say. Our parents make a contribution when they bring us into the world. I lost my dad, 55 years old. He taught me so much about life. He was an outdoor person. And we had such a brief time. I'm old enough to be his dad now. But I think about the contribution he made. He had three biological children. You leave those behind, you can, what did he say? He said, you can rejoice and to do good in your life. What did you do? What did God give you to do? God didn't give my wife a musician. They know I can't play nothing. He didn't give her a singer. She sings. I can't even help her. He didn't give her, but he gave me somebody that could protect her. I saw right off when I met her, she needed help. And I needed to take care of her on the long haul, and I signed on for that. But God gave me gifted things to do a little bit. He gave other people beautiful gifts. They could sing or paint or draw or make music or teach like Duke does and have the knowledge to help us understand verses like this. But think about your legacy. I want you to think again. He said you can rejoice and do good in what he's given you to do. Every one of us have something that we're gifted to do. Life itself is a gift. Our gifts to do in this world and make our little puff of smoke, our dust while we're here. There's nothing to us. When we're all gone, we come back, we go back to where we came from. But we leave a mark. We leave something that's important. And you can look around and this will be the last thing. I had some friends that were painters, older people. I was building a house, and I was getting them to help me with some paint. And they had a technique. They painted a governor's mansion. They painted a capitol. They got contracts with the state. They would paint a wall in a bedroom up to about 4 inches of the crown molding. And then they would cut a line all the way across with a chalk line. And they'd paint that portion up to the ceiling the same color as the ceiling. It gave the appearance that the room, the ceiling came down and wrapped around the room. I did that. Instead of another molding, they did it with paint. And they prided themselves on that. First time I'd ever seen that. I got it in my home now. I said, teach me how to do that. So we struck a chalk line and we painted, brought the ceiling color down to the green or the blue or the purple or the passionate, whatever it is, on the wall. And they were pleased when they go and say, we did that. You may not be able to paint walls. You may not be able to. Gene Mitchell can fix anything. He can make motors run. I mean, just a little bit of hay wire, a couple of pair of pliers, he can just fix anything. I can't do that. But he's making a contribution. You can have joy in what God's given you to do in this world. Come lead us in that last song.
I got a last thought.
We don't have a last song.
If you don't mind, I
I just think about people you've hauled all over the country to see that.
Yeah, I might could do that. But we are so blessed in Calvary, in the Calvary Baptist Church. We have so many talented people that our Lord has sent to us here throughout the years. I heard two of them talk tonight. You and Brother Deal. And it's such a blessing. This technology. I was telling our newest member of our church, Johnny Morrison. I was sitting in Austin, Texas, two Sundays ago, working. I was sitting in my bus waiting on my group. 10 o'clock in the morning. Well, no, it was, must have been 9 o'clock in the morning, but it was 10 o'clock here. Got my phone out. And through some miraculous thing that our technology is doing, I picked up Calvary Baptist Church. And I listened to our sermon and our service, our choir singing, beautiful. Our pastor gave an excellent message. And I watched our people come by. Right there, about to get over my telephone. Stay right here. I never thought I had seen the technology myself. I never thought that I would see Calvary Baptist Church have it. But the Lord blesses. And Amen. He has truly blessed us here at Calvary.
Amen.
And I thank you for it. Father God, thank you for what you do. Our lives. Thank you for what you do here at Calvary. Lord, I thank you for Calvary so long ago and what you did for all of us on that cross. Lord, I thank you for the thousands of people that you'll send to Calvary this weekend for Mule Day. Father, I pray that you use our people who are called by your name to share Jesus with someone this week. Lord, let that be our mission in life this week, to share your love and your testimony, our testimony. This weekend with something.